Did you say I've got a lot to learn? Well, don't think I'm trying not to learn. Since this is the perfect spot to learn. Oh, teach me tonight. Starting it right down to the XYZ of it. Help me solve the mystery of it. Oh, come on and teach me tonight.
This school, at least, is open, and we're going to learn the secrets of the lovers between the pages of the sonnets, the sweet lies whispered across the centuries and encoded into the greatest writings in history. Join us on Bardcast number 5 this Sunday, October 18th at 1 p.m. Pacific Standard Time. Tune in and Bard out.
Good day, everybody. Well, if that doesn't get you in the mood, I don't know what will. Etta James, wow. This is Bardcast episode number 5 in a continuing series of 624 Bardcasts. Mithras willing. It's October 18th of the year 2020, of the famously improved but still Gregorian calendar. As you know by now, each day of the year has a unique Shakespeare sonnet number attached to it by virtue of an ingenious system created by the brilliant and much misunderstood Dr. John Dee. Today's sonnet is number 137, which begins, "Thou blind fool love, what dost thou to mine eyes, that they behold and see not what they see?" Yet again, I did not plan this for today. October 18th just happens to be that particular sonnet number day. And in many ways, that is the topic today. Seeing not what is so clearly laid out before us in plain sight. And sonnet 137 says that so beautifully, both mathematically and poetically. But before we go there, I want to just alert you to something new on the website, tobeornottobe.org. We have a testimonial section now where people can write in and tell us what they like about the show or what they'd like to see maybe changed and what they might want to see us cover. So feel free, please send in your testimonials and we will be glad to post them from time to time on that testimonials section. Now I'm going to be reading you one at the end of the show today from one particular person from a previous podcast who wants to remain anonymous, but it's a very, very, very beautiful testimonial. So thank you for sending it in. So, talking about the math and the poetry, you may be getting by now from the various few presentations that you've seen on this, that it's all about that balancing of left brain and right brain, math, poetry, science, and art. And as that sonnet 137 points out so well, it's just the perfect blend. I'm going to read you part of that sonnet now. Thou blind fool, love, what dost thou to mine eyes? That they behold and see not what they see. They know what beauty is, see where it lies. Yet what the best is, take the worst to be. We see everything around us with our human sight, and yet what the best is, the divine sight, we seem to be sometimes not interested in. Oh, that can't be real, and that's the worst. That's too much trouble to go there. He's telling us it's not, you know. He's telling us that this he goes on, why of eyes falsehood hast thou forged hooks whereto the judgment of my heart is tied? Almost a direct reference to what we now know scientifically as forged hooks, that the there are little processes that go on in our brain that hook us to an idea, and we are helpless. It's advertising, right? Look at this, you'll think of this, you'll want to do that. You're hooked. He actually uses that expression. Whereto the judgment of my heart is tied. I'm just pulled to that. And yet it's a false idea. Why should my heart think that a several plot, several meaning to sever, make things appear different when they're not really? It's all one. Everything has been severed. Why should my heart think that a several plot, which my heart knows, the wide world's commonplace, everyone thinks that. Oh, mine eyes seeing this say, this is not to put fair truth upon so foul a face. We're putting so all our trust on in the worldly goods that we are promised, and not laying up our treasure elsewhere. And then in the end he says, in things right true my heart and eyes have erred. And he uses that expression, right and true. He uses it in Sonnet 17 as well. True rights. Thy true rights be termed a poet's rage. What does that mean? It's a mathematical expression, a geometrical expression. Right, true is right, right angle. It's the basis of the philosophy of both the speculative Freemason and the practicing Freemason, the Mason. Build the building right and true according to geometrical truth. So he's telling us both mathematically and poetically these beautiful things. Now, why does he choose that to be Sonnet 137? 137 is the biggest mystery and most important number in all of science. And I'll get into that in this presentation that I'm about to give you. So let's start it now. I'm going to show you on Keynote that you will recall that in the sonnet's title page, I'm not going to show you this again because many of you have already seen it, or you can look it up online at Bard Code Sonnets Preview, it's called, but it's on our website as well, that there's a lot of geometry on the sonnet's cover that is pointing us to the Great Pyramid. Here it is in just brief form, that these lines form perfect right angles and a circle, and they all give us these mathematical constants. 12 mathematical constants that are the same constants I found in the Great Pyramid. I'm going to show you now, just basically taking the basics. The two bases against the height gives you pi, and then it gives you gamma, and the opposite of that gives you root 3. We're not cherry picking any numbers here, we're just taking the absolute basic proportions and saying, well, if we take the side and the base and divide it by the side, it gives you root 5. Taking the two diagonals and a half base and divide it by a side and a base, it gives you on and on all of these. Now if you Google Great Pyramid and constants, you find only a very, very brief sort of very reticent, maybe they knew pi, but they couldn't really because it must be a coincidence. No, They allow us maybe pi, maybe phi, but it's got to be coincidence anyway, because how could they know that? They're crawling out of the Dark Ages. That's hidden knowledge, my friends. It's all there. The pyramid is much, much, much deeper than we even know today. And here's Shakespeare telling us the same thing. So I investigated the pyramid and found that all those 12 were there. I actually took it even further and started thinking, I wonder if there are any more that I haven't seen directly on the cover of the sonnet. Here's a graph of how I had plotted, about 30 major constants. I won't name them, they're all a bit complicated, but they're the most profound constants that we know of today. And you see that they are all within a very, very, very tiny margin of 100% accurate just by taking these basic proportions. So it goes from 99.93% accurate to 100.04% accurate when the angle is 51.843, which is the side angle of the Great Pyramid. So this is brought down to showing you just the top 20% of it. They're practically level. Now I'm going to show you at the bottom, if we increase that Great Pyramid angle a tiny, tiny bit, aside from these grey ones, which will stay 100% because they are all to do with the base, the square, and that's all to do with root 2, and that's never going to change. But the others, if you put the angle up by a mere half a degree, they start to slip out, you see, of the 100% accuracy. By 1 degree, they're getting way out, 96% accurate to 101, 94 to 102. By the time you're up by, change the angle by 2.5 degrees, it's way off. We're coming back now to the true angle. They're all at practically 100% accuracy. If you take the angle down by a half a degree, it starts to slip out again. It's telling you that only at that particular angle are all of these constants lining up like that, which is telling you, you just adjust that height just that much to get that angle right, everything falls into place. All those constants, and many more, and the foot cubic meter, which I announced in 2016 as the universal constant of measure, all there in the Great Pyramid. Now, what is astounding is that the most complex of the constants, or at least the hardest to even measure, is known as the fine structure constant, or alpha. Now, without question, it's a mystery. 137 refers to the electrons. It's the odds of an electron absorbing a single photon. And in simple Kabbalah language, to turning it to the spiritual meaning of that, it's about vessel and light, or the physical body of man and his ability to ignite the light from his soul. That's how it's seen in its spiritual sense, because really it's saying an electron turning into light. Electron is a physical property, right, of physical creation. What's the chances that it's going to emit a photon or absorb a single photon, one or the other? The chances are 1 in 137. Now, it ends up that this inversion, the fine structure constant, has a value of 1 over 137. It's analogous to a sort of an unseen force and a seen force, right? Electron is seen, and then the unseen force is this mystery of light. I'm going to show you a British physicist and professor at the University of Nottingham, Dr. Lawrence Eaves, explaining this.
This is called the fine structure constant, and so it's given by E squared, E is the charge of the electron, over H bar times C. So here's H bar, that's Planck's constant divided by 2 pi, and here's C is the speed of light. And that number is, we describe that number as dimensionless. It's not in centimeters or seconds, it's just a plain, beautiful number. And its value is 1 over 137.
Huh. Now, another way of describing it, because there are various ways, it's the ratio of these two energies, the energy needed to overcome the electrostatic repulsion between two electrons, a distance of d apart, and to the energy of a single photon. So that's for you nerds amongst you, a single photon of wavelength gamma. So, but he's showing you it's these three constants, the electric charge, h-bar, and speed of light, and it comes out to this. Now, here's a quote from Leon Lederman. 137 is the inverse of something called the fine structure constant. The most remarkable thing about this remarkable number is that it is dimension-free. Werner Heisenberg once proclaimed that all the quandaries of quantum mechanics would shrivel up when 137 was finally explained. That's from a book called The God Particle. If the universe is the answer, what is the question? That's not going to be our question and answer today, by the way, to win a T-shirt. I'm sorry, I'm not going to make it that simple for you. But his...
The fact that this number is independent of units, it makes it a very fundamental number in science, and one in which as well that if you decide to want to get in touch with some aliens on some distant planet, orbiting around a star, perhaps a bit like our own sun, it would be one of the numbers you would signal to these aliens. If to indicate that we have a scientific and technologically capable civilization on this planet.
Isn't that interesting? I mean, he's saying this number is universal. It would be universally understood no matter where you were in the cosmos. And that's the sound of the cosmos, folks. It's a beautiful thing, isn't it? Could you give us that again? No. So we end up with... He's going to say more about it, actually. Part of this, which I will disagree with ever so slightly, but let's have him have his say. This is Wolfgang Pauli. He was so obsessed with it. The theoretical determination of the fine structure constant is certainly the most important of the unsolved problems of modern physics. We believe that any regression to the ideas of classical physics, as for instance to the use of the classical field concept, cannot bring us nearer to this goal. To reach it, we shall presumably have to pay with further revolutionary changes of the fundamental concepts of physics. Wow, how true that is. With a still farther digression from the concepts of classical theories. Wolfgang, you were right, and I think he's the guy who ended up dying in hospital, bless him. And he, as he was wheeled into his room where he would breathe his last breath, he noticed the number on the door was 137. And he said, yeah, perfect. So here's our doctor again.
So, for example, it wouldn't be much use if you communicated with them and said, look, I weigh 80 kilograms and my height is 1 meter 80. These numbers wouldn't mean anything to them. What would mean something to them is the value of this fine structure constant alpha, because they would know that number as well. If they've made telescopes and have got electronic equipment and are sending out radio waves and so on, they will know that number for sure.
And as I say, the only thing I disagree with him on that is that, yeah, you know, when you said, well, they wouldn't know the numbers of meters, or, well, I beg to disagree, because I think we've just shown more. Quite recently, that the universal constant of measure is itself a constant. Foot to cubit to meter is utterly perfectly embedded in the basic proportions of the pyramid and sitting in the same place when the angle is 51.843 as all these other constants. They are inherent in each other. Newton was searching for that his whole life, couldn't find it because he didn't even know such a thing as meters then. But now we've been able to prove it. So, one more quote. Physicists love this number, not just because it is dimensionless, but also because this is a combination of three fundamental constants of nature. Why do these constants come together to make the particular number 1 over 137 and not some other number? Dunno, afraid. And so...
Feynman, for example, in his classical, those three classic textbooks he wrote for the undergraduate courses at Caltech. I can't quote from him directly, but he felt that this was a number, you know, that all physicists were very, very deeply attached to, and almost has a magic to it, because there's no theory that explains why it has the value it has. I mean, this is the mystery of it, it's just this value. But you can be sure that if the value were a little bit different from the value it actually has, we wouldn't be around here talking about it now.
And it's the crux of it. If it were the tiniest, tiniest bit off from this, we wouldn't exist. I can quote him directly, actually. There is a most profound and beautiful question associated with the observed coupling constant E, the amplitude for a real electron to emit or absorb a real photon. This is Feynman speaking. It has been a mystery ever since it was discovered more than 50 years ago, and all good theoretical physicists put this number up on their wall and worry about it. Feynman had quite a good sense of humor. Immediately, you would like to know where this number for a coupling comes from. Is it related to pi, or perhaps to the base of natural logarithms? Nobody knows. It's one of the great damn mysteries of physics, a magic number that comes to us with no understanding by man. You might say the hand of God wrote that number, and we don't know how he pushed his pencil. And yet here we have Sonnet 137 telling us that. I've read parts of it to you, so I'm not going to read it again, but I wanted to show you so that you see. It starts with the triple tau. And then halfway through, when he's describing the falsehood of these forged hooks, whereto the judgment of my heart is tied. W, 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 W. That's his encoding as well. W, W, the two Williams. He's one William the writer and one William the writer that we're intent on trying to pretend it is, the man from Stratford, Shakespeare. The mask. Right? The writer is the peer, the peer of the realm behind the mask. That's why we've changed our little logo. Peer behind the mask. It's rather clever, I think. Oh, I'm very pleased with that one. The peer behind the mask. Shakespeare. But look, he's put these clues within Sonnet 137. And unless you think I'm really, really saying, oh, adding too much to this. No, he couldn't possibly know 137. Well, you're in for a bit of a surprise on that, too. We'll get to that. But now going back to the pyramid, you saw how I took just basically the basic proportions, not cherry-picking at all, just, the base is 440, the height is 280 cubits, and everything else follows from that, given. I mean, everything else is literally inherent in those two basic numbers. And so I wondered, is the fine structure constant in the pyramid, as well as those other constants that I've seen on the cover of the sonnets? And it turns out to be this simple: height and diagonal divided by the side slope and twice the base gives you the fine structure constant. To 99.9998% accuracy. What? yeah, what? How can that be? What about the reduced Planck constant? That's this, which he mentioned, H bar. Again, just that simple. Okay, a side slope and a height and a diagonal divided by two corner slopes and a side slope. It's called the reduced Planck constant. It's the 99.99995% accurate. These are the most accurate of all the constants. Pi is close, phi is close, e is close, e minus one is close. All of them are there. And I go looking for this and I go, oh my goodness. The most complex of all, the most fundamental of all, the ones that are telling us the utter simplest basic truth of what are the chances that physical reality, the electron, can turn into spiritual reality, light. Let there be light. It's these mysterious numbers that together create 137, or its inverse. And it's accurate to basically round it to five decimal places. 99.9995. And here's Shakespeare, and Dee through Shakespeare on the mathematical side telling us about that. And the two of them together are what give us this beautiful equation that Professor just showed us. I'm now going to take it to another level. I was blessed to be in the Great Pyramid on my second trip there. We did the usual bakshish, which means a bribe. you give enough money to a guard and they'll let you in privately. And I was there one morning before all the tourists would get there very, very early, and had it to myself for an hour. So I was meditating, sitting there, and I was thinking, you know, it's very interesting. I know that this structure, the height and the width and the length of it, is what gives us golden ratio and gives us a 3-4-5 triangle diagonally across. You don't see it on a wall or a floor, but it's a diagonal 3-4-5, kind of hidden very cleverly, and that by doing that you end up seeing that it's actually giving you golden ratio as well. And those are sort of basics, and you'd think, well, all right, any great, you know, if they knew something about mathematics and geometry, they would know that. Doesn't explain how it was built, but still the math. My dear friend Nala Berkey in Australia has done wonderful graphics occasionally for me, and these are his graphics, where he shows what I had intuited. I'm sitting there, I'm meditating, and all of a sudden I got this realization that the sarcophagus is the only other thing that's sitting there. You're looking at a sarcophagus in this perfect, otherwise perfect shape that is geometrically perfect to give you golden ratio and the other things that I've mentioned. But what's the sarcophagus doing there? We know it's not the burial chamber for a pharaoh, all right? You can only slide it into that room on its side because its height is greater, slightly greater than its width. And as I was sitting there meditating, I had the intuition, oh, I think it's to do with that. If you turn it on its side, you can measure how many there would be, how many would fit into the height of the King's Chamber, and how many would fit into the width. And a quick sort of back of the mind calculation, I thought, I think it's 6 by 5. Anyway, that started me off. And once I left, I went home and did the math on it and found it was absolutely accurate. Here's a visual representation of that. So there's the sarcophagus sitting there alone, and if you turn it on its side and you think, all right, because if you did it vertically, it wouldn't work. When you turn it on its side, precisely 6 fit to the height, and precisely 5 fit to the width. Well, that's a very interesting combination, 5 and 6, hermetic numbers that are really important. And then you calculate the length of it, and you say, well, how many, well, why did they choose that particular length? I wondered how many would fit in. And it's not an exact number, at least not a perfect number of lengths of sarcophagi, because there's the one. And it turns out that if you put them all in together, you end up with 137.5 of them. And now 137.5 is another way of expressing golden ratio, because for those of you who know that the golden ratio is a length compared to another length, right? If you divide angles according to golden ratio, you get 137.5 degrees, and its balance is on the other side of that. So it's telling you that again, but I thought, well, that's weird, that's redundant. They've already told us the golden ratio. Then I realized, oh, the sarcophagus is almost exactly, precisely, half of it is air and half of it is stone. Its volume inside is precisely the volume of the stone that it is made of in the outside of it. And then surrounding that is then just air of the King's Chamber. So if you literally calculate the amount of nothingness in the King's Chamber, including the half of a sarcophagus that's inside the sarcophagus itself, then what number do you end up with? You end up with 137 nothingnesses and just a half of a sarcophagus of somethingnesses. So they very cleverly and very poetically have summed up that whole mystery of what the fine structure is about. It's about turning solid electron mass into poof, going back to spirit, going back to invisibility, to nothingness. It's 137 to 1, the sarcophagus to the king's chamber. Now that is a paradigm shifting thought, because they could have chosen any width and height. They didn't have to make it be precisely 6 by 5. All right. That gives you then 30 of them blocked up against a wall. And they could have chosen any length. All right. That's negotiable, but they chose just the length that would then give you 137.5 of them would fill the king's chamber perfectly, and 137 of them would be nothingness. It's astounding. It would be telling you, we know all this. We know this stuff. We're way ahead of you guys. Catch up. And so, we are not going to that yet. I'm going to tell you about the poetic side of it now, because you've just seen a heavy dose of math, right? And the whole thing is, okay, Sonnet 137, is he really telling us he knows that? That's wild, and yet it's pretty wild that the Egyptians knew it, isn't it? So somebody knew this, and somebody's in connection with the Egyptian mystery schools and the Pythagoreans and the Thaleses and the Rosicrucians and the, right, on through all these secret organizations. And we know that Shakespeare and John Dee are with the Rosicrucians, as is Bacon. And so is it a stretch? Let's go back now then to the video that I put together as a promo for this show, which is show number 5, and 5 is what? 5 is the pentagram, and 5 pentagram is the 5-pointed star, and 5-pointed star is all about golden ratio, isn't it? And here they're showing us that the golden ratio is intimately connected to the fine structure constant in the pyramid, and specifically in the king's chamber. So I now want to take you to the other side of it that he's telling us about in Sonnet 137, the poetry of it, the unseen against the seen. We see, but we don't see. Thou blind fool, love, what dost thou to mine eyes? All right, so here's the sonnet's cover again, and I'm going to take you through the way I put it together in the Etta James video, but on my own timing, I'm just going to take you through it so that I can talk over it. That was the geometry on the cover. Here's the coding on the dedication, the 624. And then you go through the various sonnets, and as you get to a certain one further up here, all sonnets have to have 14 lines. That's their structure. And yet, suddenly, at sonnet 99, he has, 15 lines. He has one extra line. Of course, it's called a mistake. he just had a bad day. Everybody has writer's block sometimes. So, and you continue on, and then you look at this particular sonnet, and you've got, this one has only 12 lines. It's two missing, and you've got two blank parentheses, which are going to make a lot more sense to you once you see the full conclusion to The Fisher Kings. I've got Act 1 and Act 2 up on the website now, and Act 3, I promise, is coming soon. You keep on asking me, people say, when's Act 3 coming? Don't hold me in suspense like this. But we've sort of had a lot of other things to do getting Bardcast together, and only a certain number of hours in the day. How many hours are there in the day, by the way? So something like 29, isn't it? 33? Yeah, about 33, I think. Yeah, that's what we're working on at the moment. So those two blank parentheses oh my God, that is going to hit you so deeply in your heart, you won't be able to stand it. It's the most beautiful thing, but I'm not going to go there right now. We're going to carry on and show that, okay, he takes us all the way to the end. 153 should be the perfect triangular number, but he kind of messes with our heads a little and gives us 154. And that's why no one's really noticed that it's a triangular structure. It's not a perfect triangular number, is it? It's 154. But 153 and 154 are meant to be, they are the same sonnet. They're just written slightly differently, and they're all about balancing opposites, light and dark, heat and cold, sun and moon, male and female. And then he throws in a sonnet, not a sonnet, a poem at the end of the sonnets called A Lover's Complaint. And this is even described as being, by a lot of researchers, oh, it can't be by Shakespeare, it is so bad. Okay, maybe it's so bad because he's actually putting so many codes into it that it's not really about the poetry, but the poetry is pretty brilliant anyway. But anyway, some people have their opinion about it. And it goes to the end there, and you go, there we are at the end. And so that's what I showed you in the Etta James promo, and it goes to the lovers, and I highlighted that as a little clue to jumpstart us into this what will be our question for today. I'm going to take you back and show you, well, okay, if we go back to A Lover's Complaint, it is considered correct printing to always put part of the title on the left, part of the title on the right page, A Lover's Complaint. And you turn the page and you've got A Lover's Complaint, A Lover's Complaint, A Lover's Complaint, A Lover's Complaint. And then the final page, it says, The Lovers. Now that can be nothing but absolutely intentional. The printers would have gone nuts trying to sort that out. Why if you put Lovers? It should be Lovers. It screws us up. We don't know what we're doing with the pagination. No, don't worry about that, dear old chap. Yes, it's a mistake, but just leave it. No, it's not a mistake. Look down at the bottom of it, the last stanza, and I showed you this in the last broadcast with Adam Apollo, and I'll just recap just this part of it where I showed you that the very last word of the very last line of the sonnets, sonnet 154, tells us that the answer is in the altar, and he tells us that he is Edward de Vere, and that his code number 1001 is there, and his other code, WW, put together as part of his signature. This is the last quatrain, the last stanza, sorry, of A Lover's Complaint. I'm going to just wipe out those lines and just show you the very last line. And as I said, I showed you this before, but just to recap. The last line says, a new perverted reconciler made finis. Finis is Latin for the end, right? Finished, over, done. But another way of saying finis is in fine, in the end. Even the two dots, he always makes the punctuation work as well. The two dots become a colon. In the end, print conceals what? Oh, these capital letters, look. Made has a capital M. And at the beginning of the sentence, and the big I. Capital letters, I am. It's the name of God, isn't it? The I am that I am. I am. In the end, print conceals, I am. Well, that's pretty conclusive. So, I am Edward de Vere. He's telling you that. The very last thing he's going to say in the very last page of the very last poem at the end of the sonnets. And at the same time, he's put all this row of O's here. What is that about? And this wrong heading, The Lovers. So there he's telling us he's Edward de Vere. Here he's telling us, what is Edward de Vere's code number? Does anybody remember? Oh, I forget. We can't talk to you. You can't talk to us. You can comment. That's not the question, by the way. But his code number was 40. 4-0. And he riffs on that with Hamlet dies and then goes, oh, 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 in the first folio. Four O's gives you 40. Well, there's the four O's, but oh, there's another O. Now, he referred to himself a lot as just Oxford. O meant Oxford. So here he's given us his final sign out, his code number, 40, Oxford, but then another additional Oxford. meaning it can mean nothing but, oh, I have a child. Another Oxford. Okay. He's telling us he's Edward de Vere. He's telling us this is him. He's telling us 40. He's telling us this is about another child. And right at the top, he says the lovers instead of a lovers. So, what can that possibly be about? I rather think that that should be our question. Why is that heading changed to the lovers? So, to sum up, we're now at the point of the question, and I'm looking at the wrong camera. There we are. I'm going to tell you that the fine print there is telling us Edward de Vere. We are at the end of that portion where I've shown you that it's the lovers, and I want to ask you, what do you think would be the purpose in putting that there as a very, very obvious clue? The question is, we're at the giveaway, and I just want to mention one thing before we do it. Last show, we had a bit of a confusion over who was essentially doing, who was the winner. PC Clark showed up on our feed, and we announced Paul Clark as the winner. And then we checked with one of our team members who was checking on the Facebook remotely, and they saw that someone else had beaten him by 2 seconds. Katie Norris. Well, Katie was very, very, very noble and generous about it, and she said, "Oh, don't worry, just give it to PC because you've already announced him." But obviously, we corrected that. We sent her a T-shirt, and we sent PC a T-shirt. And then I was later checking the comments myself later that night, trying to answer some of the questions, and I noticed that there was another anomaly, and a name had shown up that we hadn't seen before. And that name was Qua Fox. And I've tried to find whether it's a he or a she online. Can't find anybody by the name of Qua Fox on Facebook. So, Qua, if you are on, please tell us, because you actually tied with Katie Norris 2 seconds ahead of PC, and we want to give you a shirt as well. We don't want you to feel left out. But all I can say is either it was our fault, we missed it, or somehow or other Facebook was a little out in its precision of timing. I don't know. But we've got still a lot of technological hurdles to overcome here. We're trying to do our best to get it right. So forgive us. We'll send you a T-shirt. I would really like to find out who you are and make that right to you. So given this question, once we give you the question, the prize is going to be, for the first few weeks, we gave away books and then we gave away a T-shirt. So we have a lot of new designs of T-shirts, and so I'm going to run a video right now and show you just the Bardcode store. So you can go to the store, check it out, and the winner can pick themselves a T-shirt of the old or new. We've got those new designs that are the peer behind the T-shirts. They weren't in that promo, but if you go to the website, you'll see them. So for the winner, whoever it is on this question, which I'm about to give you, you can go there, pick out a t-shirt, and we'll be happy to send it to you. So now, I need to show you first what the question is visually. The lovers is the anomaly, isn't it? He's telling us something very, very specific about the lovers. And so it's an anagram. Now, I'm going to show you, if you were to go to a modern-day anagram finder, this is the result for the lovers. And as you see, there's a lot of anagrams. And so you might think, well, I can't possibly find the anagram for that. I mean, what? Shelve? Shelve is a word. Rot is a word. Does that mean that's right? Shelve? Rot? Here? Vaults? Well, there are certain rules about anagrams from 400 years ago. One is that, in fact, I'll read to you from Decoding Shakespeare, how I actually outlined the rules for everyone so that they would know that they were dealing with this from a scientific perspective. John Dee is the person that's sort of made this whole system. And essentially, the anagrams that they used back in those days, all letters must be used once and only once. That was one rule. All words must be dictionary valid, or in this case, known to have been used during the late 16th, early 17th century. In other words, it had to be a word that they would be using. So vaults would not be relevant. Let's see any others we've got here. Revels hot. Okay. Revels, that was a word they used. They called their playtime revels. But I don't think he's going to be saying, oh, we had hot revels, as his most important thing that he'd be saying at the end of a sacred work. That's the other part about it, is I've found that whenever he's going to say something deeply significant, either at the center or at the beginning or at the very end of his work, it's going to be beautiful. He's going to work it so that it is a deep spiritual message. So in other words, there may be many anagrams that can be made, but there are rules for choosing what might be the right one, because it has to be, as I say, a word that would have been in use at that time. And if you're not sure, you can check the etymology of a word, and you can simply find out, was it in use back then? If it wasn't, then obviously that's not the solution. He revolts. Okay, you could say, well, that's a sentence, he revolts, and maybe it's got some kind of connection, but again, it's not. From experience, I can tell you that there are literally hundreds of anagrams and hundreds of codes, and they're always deeply, deeply meaningful. So just to say he revolts, that wouldn't be it. This is a sacred work. It's going to be something that is so intensely meaningful, and when you see it, you will realize, oh yeah, well, that obviously is intentional. Here's another one. He rolls TV. There are all, you know, there was a modern day anagram, but TV, no, don't think so, right? Let's rev on. Oh, let's revo. In other words, what I'm showing you here is you can look in a modern day anagram software finder. It's not going to help you. I'm going to tell you clearly, honestly, none of those is it. We're looking for something very simple and very special and to do with the entire story of the fact that this is about a child that he had. And we all know the depth of the story goes to he had a child with the Queen on 12th night. It's known that Edward de Vere and the Queen were together on January the 5th, and that 9 months later a child was born, Henry Rosalie. And Henry Rosalie is certainly the child who is being mentioned in the dedication here. So you're seeing on the left Mr. W. H. That's been a source of contention for many researchers for years and years and years, decades, a couple of hundred years. Who is Mr. W. H.? Well, if it's true, and let's just say we don't have proof yet, that Henry Rosalie, who is generally considered to be the fair youth of the sonnets and the person that this is dedicated to, and Henry Rosalie was born literally 9 months after the 12th night, the time that we knew that De Vere and the Queen were together for probably the first time or second time, and that Shakespeare wrote Twelfth Night about that experience. She's the Virgin Queen, and she can't let it be known that she's had a child, and that child would have been hidden away into the family of a noble. And indeed, Henry Wriothesley was brought up as the third Earl of Southampton. So he's known as the third Earl of Southampton. But if this whole thing is about that cover-up, that really he was the child of the Queen and of Edward de Vere, he should have been the next king when the Queen passed away. And as we know, that didn't happen, because by that time, she'd performed this almost miracle of winning England, beat the Spanish Armada. She was beginning to be thought of as a deity. It was impossible that we could beat the Spanish Armada, but we did in 1588. And there you go, well, okay, she's buying her own press. She's absolutely, by the time she's dying in 1603, she's going senile for sure. But she had a decision to make, didn't she? Continue the Tudor dynasty, or go down in history as the Virgin Queen. It would have been very hard for her, after reigning for so long, to say, about that virginity thing. And so this is the deep, dark secret at the base of this whole thing. Did they have a child? Was that child supposed to be the king? Was he prevented from being the king? Wriothesley was in the Tower at the time that the Queen was passing, on charges of treason. Everyone else involved in the Essex Rebellion, as it was called, was either executed, or I think a couple got off where there was no proof. But certainly Wriothesley was held in the Tower awaiting death every single day. They had him exactly where they wanted him, and had they executed him, if the whole cover-up was about Oxford being the father of a child with the Queen, then Oxford would have just simply spit it out and said the truth. But so long as his child was alive, he wasn't going to say anything. And so those in power had managed a coup, and he was not going to be the king. And once James was announced as the next king, Tudor dynasty is over, and now the Jacobean period starts. And that's the whole thing deeply at the root of this, is the correct lineage on the throne. The first act of the king, the new King James, before he even rode down to London to be crowned, is the first official act. He released Wriothesley from the Tower. Wriothesley was on death row for treason. He commuted his sentence, returned him. So the reason it says Mr. W.H. is he was in the Tower, and all his rights and all his titles and all his lands and everything was stripped from him. He became just mere Mr. Wriothesley H. Mr. W.H. And then when the deal was done and the new king had been accepted as the succeeding monarch, the first thing he did was let Wriothesley off. It stinks to high heaven, no matter which way you look at it. But that was the deal. The deal was done. Wriothesley got to live, and he had all his titles reversed, and he was back in business. So it seems to be that that's what this is about. Now, we don't have the utter DNA concrete proof yet, except I have the nearest thing to it, which is the scientific proof that the altar has something in it that it shouldn't necessarily have in it, and it's 250 times the size it should be. And so that's one prong of our approach, is to get the truth out. So leaving that aside for now, I have this much, much, much more coming in Bardcasts to come, because we're right on the verge of announcing something even greater than having discovered the altar. But I can't talk about that today. So, we are at this junction. We've got Mr. W.H., right? Now, my question to you is, then, Now, I'm going to give you some time to do this because we want to check absolutely clearly that we get the right person. But having known the background, that it's about a hidden person who might not have been Henry Rosalie, but might have been Henry, the son of Edward de Vere, there's your clue. So can you solve the lover's anagram? Now, in the meantime, while you're working that out, remember Jill and Rodney? I'm going to give you some time to work on that. But here, if you're not up for doing the anagram, you can watch this little bit of entertainment. The last time we checked in, the tension was getting a little high, wasn't it? And we asked you to tune in to find out whether Jill and Nigel's marriage could possibly withstand the pressure of this all too common fallout over Shakespeare preferences. It's decimating marriages all over the world, as you know. And sure enough, it looked like another one had bit the dust over the thorny problem of Bard versus the pub.
Jill's new boyfriend, Rodney, take 7.
Don't mind him, he's sulking.
Your ex, I presume.
Oh, yeah.
Haven't wasted any time, I see.
Ignore him.
And this is what caused all the trouble?
Well, he's just not sensitive like you, Rodney.
I understand, darling. I've always been bloody sensitive.
Oh, you are, Rodney. It takes a real man to truly appreciate the bard.
Thank you, Dimple Cheeks. That is a Shakespeare expression, isn't it, Dimple Cheeks?
Jill's new boyfriend, Rodney. Take 8.
Sorry, line again, please.
But wait, the fickleness of lovers, as Shakespeare has tried to warn us over and over and over, especially in Sonnet 137, too. It looks like Rodney blew it with that dimple cheeks comment. It's not a Shakespeare phrase, I'm afraid. And now Jill appears to have reconciled with Nigel. At least they seem to be back together on this video.
Right, so this Sunday, Alan Green's doing another masterclass, right? You'll know about that, Bardcast, about this guy, Edward de Vere, Oxford, right? It was the real Shakespeare. Now, the funny thing is, you stick your hands together like this, you do the Chris Nolan Tenet thing, like that, right? You've seen the movie. And he changes to Sir Francis Bacon. You see that happen? I'll show you again. You put your hands together like this, right? Just, whoa. Is it time travel? Oh, I don't know. It's bloody Oxford again. It's really weird. Anyway, Alan will be explaining this in a masterclass this Sunday. A short one, I hope. Not like the last one went on for bloody 3.5 hours. So tune in, Bard out and that, and let's hear it for Alan and the Bardcast. Okay? Ooh, there it goes again. Shake shifters, eh? See? Telling you, bloody time travellers. Weird.
So there you go. The lovers. There's nothing you can count on, is there? It's just fickleness on planet Earth. Tune in next show to find out if Jill and Nigel stay together or who knows. But it seems right now you need a bit more time. So no one's come up with a correct answer yet to the anagram? All right, good. I thought not. This is a tricky one, but it gets very, very deep, so keep on at it. It's a little simpler than it actually looks, so just think about what I told you about the clues about who Henry Rosalie might actually be. So in the meantime, I'm going to tell you a little more information that will help you understand how John Dee is connected to the fine structure constant and how he may well know that. It's a very interesting thing. Let's go back to the structure of Freemasonry. This triple tau This is an abbreviation of a presentation that I've given to you before, but you know that it kind of represents the three crosses on Calvary, which were not Christian Latin crosses, but were just simply tau crosses, cheaper for the Romans. And three taus together became known as a symbol for Calvary, and therefore for the name of God, and that they were put together into this shape of a T and an H, three T's together that look like a T and an H. They have these Latin meanings: clavis ad thesaurum, key to the treasure, theca ubi res pretiosa deponitur, place where the precious thing is concealed, templum hieroslima, Solomon's temple. There's the triple tau right in the middle of the gravestone. Here are the THs in the gravestone, but they're not THs, are they? They're ligatured together, just like that symbol of a TH that is really three Ts put together. It's telling you that in the gravestone there is a symbolism, there is a code. Same thing was present in the monument. Shakespeare's monument in Holy Trinity has a whole bunch of THs in there, and it has as well a couple of ligatures in the middle, M and E ligatured together. The TH means the name of God. I am that I am. And then M-E means me. But does it mean the little ego me, or the capital M-E, self, the I, the divine within us all? They're in a certain shape of 426 or 624, read the other way. Now, what maybe you haven't seen before is how we make these into grids. Now, I must tell you, I was not the first person to find this at all. In fact, this was the person who inspired me most at the very beginning of my journey back in 2004. His name was Art Neuendorfer, and he had discovered that if you put the sonnet's dedication into a 19 grid, that means take all these letters in the dedication and go up to number 19 and then put them in again, and again, and again. You keep putting all the letters through. He discovered that this isn't the only way you can find a triple tau, because it's there, a triple tau, but it is the only way that you can find a triple tau next to an inverted tau cross. And he thought that other coding that had been found by John Rollett that said these sonnets all by E. Vere, the fourth T, he had thought, well, perhaps the fourth T means the fourth tau cross, right? There's three on Calvary, but who was the fourth person to be crucified? Well, that was St. Peter, wasn't it? St. Peter crucified upside down, saying, I'm not worthy to be crucified the same way as my Lord. And that happened around about AD 69. And so Neuendorfer had found this triple tau, and next to it a De Vere tau cross, inverted. Pretty dramatic finding at the time. Okay, now for some reason nobody took it any further, but I decided to sort of piggyback on Art's work and say, well, I wonder if I can find that in the gravestone. And here's, I put the gravestone into many grids, but I found that the one that worked is a 17 grid, in which you find a triple tau and an inverted tau cross right next to it with the family name Vere's. Well, that was interesting. Maybe it's saying verse, his poetry, but still, it's the name Vere with an S on. So I'm looking at the monument. Now, that's a long... there's a lot of letters in there, and you can finally find one grid that has a triple tau in it against an inverted tau cross. They're at opposite ends, but they're fairly perfectly spaced, so I'm going to bring it together like this. Triple tau and E. Vere, Edward de Vere. So you've got the beginnings of some sort of consistent pattern in the sonnets grid, in the monument grid, in the gravestone grid. I will just tell you one other little side note to this. I don't have it in this presentation, but I will show it in detail at some point. You know, I wondered for the longest time, why did D, well, you'll see in a moment that it is indeed D doing this, but for now, just accept that it is. Why did D pick these numbers? Why a 19 grid? Why a 17 grid? Why a 55 grid? A researcher called David Roper had found an interesting code in a 34 grid of the monument. It doesn't have a triple tau in it, but it has a message in it, which I had shown last week, last two weeks ago, and unfortunately we had a technical glitch. I'd pressed the wrong button and missed the audio for a certain while and didn't credit David, so I want to credit him properly now. David Roper had come up with this 34 grid of the monument, which says, "So test him, I vow, he is E. de Vere Shakespeare." The interesting thing is, and I'll show this at another presentation, there actually are three triple towers and inverted tower crosses, all embedded. They're just kind of hidden, stacked into each other, right in the center. So it ends up that D had chosen a 19 grid, a 17 grid, a 34 grid, and a 55 grid, and that happens to be, drumroll, the precise ratios of the King's Chamber when placed not into feet or cubit or meters, but to the nearest integer, to the nearest absolute integer. The King's Chamber is 17 wide, 19 high, 34 in length, and the false door at the west end is two heights and one width, which adds up to 55. So the false door is the 55. So he chose 17, 19, 34, and 55 to give us the grids as another clue to say the King's Chamber is where it's all, the whole secret is of the fine structure constant, etc., etc. Altogether, then, anyway, in these three that do have very clearly visible triple towers, you've got three inverted Vere crosses, De Vere, E Vere, and Veres, which is poetic reference, isn't it, to St. Peter actually being crucified three times. No, not three times. He denied Christ three times. Christ predicted, "You will deny me three times by the time the cock crows." And so when he eventually was crucified, he said, "No, you can't crucify me the same way as my Lord crucified me, upside down." So there's a very deep poetic reference to that. Now, looking further, I went into the gravestone, 17 grid, and I saw ears and eyes perfectly balanced as Freemasonic T-squares against each other. Well, here's a picture of Her Madge in her favorite frock, which is covered in ears and eyes. And what she's telling us with that is that I have my ears and eyes everywhere. I have my spies everywhere. I hear everything. I see everything. Don't mess with me. That's a warning, isn't it? Well, John Dee was known as her ears and eyes, and he was also known as 007. Because this was his code number. And there's his name, 00D, in the shape of a 7. And so that shows not only brilliance in his cryptographic ability, but what a sense of humor. And this isn't the only time. I've found the 007 signature in, I would say at least 15 or 16 grids of codes. And then enter D's angels. He's known for having what he called angelic communications for about 8 years under the table, hidden, couldn't talk about it because, he could be burned at the stake for it. But it's all in his diaries. He's talking with angels. And on a certain date, they channeled to him this grid known as the Enochian Tables. And there I've put it into a spreadsheet to show the letters so that I could work out what the encoding was. But this was delivered to him on a long session that started on June 24th, 1584. June 24th is what? 624. 624, okay. That's the day that De Vere disappears, June 24th. And it was 20 years before the actual day that De Vere, in quotes, died, 2004. Now here's the quadrants. There is 156 letters in each quadrant. 156 times 4, anybody know what that is? Yeah, it is 624. There's 624 characters. Then I put all the sonnets, dedication, total letters and dots, and monument inscription, total letters and punctuation, gravestone inscription, total letters and punctuation all together, and can you guess what that adds up to? I think you got it. So, it's pretty obvious John Dee is telling us, all right, I've written the sonnet's dedication, the monument and the gravestone to be 624 characters exactly, including those ligatures counting as one and including the punctuation. And I've had this thing channeled to me on 624, June 24, 1584 by angels. And it's an Enochian tables grid. And I'm going to therefore write the sonnet's dedication and the monument and the gravestone to fit into this. I mean, how else can you possibly think of it? It's 624 characters, which would be called the ciphertext, that go into the plain text of the Enochian tables. All you need to know is the key. And they go in this order. There's six lines, two lines, four lines in the sonnet's dedication, then two, then six, then two in the monument, and four in the gravestone. So it goes in 6-2-4-2-6-2-4. You know, it has to be that way in order for it to make it perfect, and so that's the way you know the order in which to put them in. But we need the key. Well, remember, clavis ad thesaurum meant key to the treasure. It's one of the secret Rosicrucian and Freemasonic meanings to the TH symbolism of the name of God. And it means nothing is wanting but the key. So, okay, TT is the key. T.T. is the name Thomas Thorpe, the so-called publisher, Thomas Thorpe, T.H.T.H. The T.T.'s, there are five sets of double T's in the ciphertext, and they point across to the ciphertext in the Enochian tables, and you isolate those letters. And it says living page. But unheard of in cryptography, the key is in the plain text as well. There are five sets of double T's in the Enochian tables. So they've switched places. And those double T's now point back to the letters in the now plain text. And those letters isolated say, yo, stigmata. Yo, middle English word meaning, look carefully at the stigmata. There's a living page. There's a page kept alive, a document. Wow. But Malvolio in Twelfth Night, that significant play that was written about the love affair between our Queen, Virgin, and Edward de Vere, if he's the sole writer of it. I will still reserve judgment on that. I just want the truth. I'm not categorically saying it has to be him. There's other information coming out that I'm going to be happy to be delivering to you over the next sets of podcasts. It's very, very interesting because Bacon is an enormously huge part of this as well. But obviously I've done the bulk of my work on 16 years work on finding Edward de Vere everywhere. And in Twelfth Night, Malvolio, on page 264 of the first folio, tells us what to do. He says, if this fall into thy hand, revolve. Oh, okay, revolve. Wow, this just gets silly, isn't it? I mean, that's not possible. Are you telling me that you literally are going to revolve it and that now the double T keys are going to point to completely different letters in the Enochian tables? They're going to give you a message? What? Angels? Okay, all right, well, let's find out. And then the double T's in the Enochian tables are going to point back in the other direction. They're going to give you completely different letters. But you put them together and it says, I have hewn desiderata. I have cut. Hewn means cut into stone. Desiderata is Latin for my desires, what I want you to know. And the whole thing says, living page, yo stigmata, I have hewn desiderata. It's not an accident. It's about a 1 in 6.5 billion chance of even the anagrams themselves coming and working out. But it's a Shakespearean rhyming couplet. It rhymes. Living page, yo stigmata, I have hewn desiderata. It's beyond doubt that that's what he's telling us. It's inside the stigmata. The stigmata wounds are on the, where? They're on the altar stone. And they might be in the stained glass window you see stigmata. But the only place in the Holy Church where you see stigmata, the wounds themselves, are on a Holy of Holies altar stone. It's telling us, look at the stigmata carefully. Where I have cut into stone what I want you to know. It's very clear it's there. So therefore, I went and did a concert, two concerts actually, one in November 2011 and one on the Shakespeare's birthday, 2012, here where you see I'm giving a concert. The whole church is covered in flowers. This is my second attempt to scan the altar But we weren't able to that time. But I'd already got it in the previous time anyway. And each time was in front of an audience, and we got what was inside the altar, and we got... So we've got the scientific proof. Now, why am I telling you all of this? To tell you about John Dee and his essential work with the Enochian tables and putting his name and 007 into the grid of the gravestone, etc. So, do we have an answer? We have an answer.
We have a winner.
Oh my God, I'm really thrilled to hear that. That means I don't have to give you the question that I was building up to give you on this, just in case no one had the answer. So, oh, well, I think this deserves a drum roll. So first of all, show us the answer, Alejandro. Wow. That's great. We're going to hold off on telling you who won it. I'm going to show you why that is the answer. So back to my keynote presentation. H. Vere lost. Well done, somebody. Oh, I'm so thrilled. I actually thought, I was saying to this morning, I got to tell you, we had the whole show worked out, all set to go yesterday. Worked it out, did the dry run, got all the cues worked out, etc., etc. And we're not getting much sleep. And it's just, I got to bed finally about 2 in the this morning. I thought, oh gosh, got it done. We're all ready. We're ready to go. And we had a different question, which is the question that I was just now going to ask you. But it's a very easy one. It would be so easy that everyone would have got it, and you'd all be fighting over microseconds. And I thought, I woke up this morning at 4:15 after having 2 hours and 15 minutes sleep, in a fever sweat of going, I've got to change it. I've got a much better idea. We'll do the lover's one. And then I thought, so I stayed up and worked on it till about 8 this morning, then got a nap in for an hour, and then we started rehearsing the new version of the show. But I said to Alejandro, I said, you know, it's not going to work. No one's going to get this. So that's what I thought. And so that's why we got just ready. We've gone a bit over an hour. I wanted to keep this masterclass to be a very short one because that guy said it was too bloody long at three and a half hours, you know. So, I mean, it's one thing if you've got special guests on and we go deep into our anecdotal back and forth. Oh, that's great fun. You can go for 3 or 4 hours doing that. But a masterclass, it's a lot to absorb. And I'd made a decision that I'm going to try to keep them to about an hour, maybe slightly more. So, because then you need to go back and relax and see it again and fully grok it, you know, in that word, grok, really, really digest it. And so that you can move on to the next and the next and the next. So my determination has been to make these short. So it's longer because I thought, okay, so nobody got it. So I'm going to show you this other stuff now, and we'll go back to the original plan of giving you this question, which you're not going to get now because we have a winner. But I'm going to show you why he or she is the winner. Don't know yet. The lovers. I mean, it's very obvious that this is absolutely deliberate. It cannot be anything but. He's telling us he's Edward de Vere. The print conceals his name. The four O's are there. There's another child O there, Oxford. And the lover should be a lover. So... And I've already told you that, yeah, that Mr. WH is Henry Rosely. H. Rosely, but if he's not Rosely, if he is the child of Edward de Vere and the Queen, then the writer would be saying, no, he's H. Vere. He's Henry Vere. And in that case, his claim to the throne would be lost because he gave it up. And King James did a deal. You're in the tower. I can give the go-ahead. You could die any time. And so I do believe that that's what happened. Oxford basically said, checkmate. Okay, you got it. I don't want you to kill my son. We give up the throne. Now, so James is now announced as the successor. The Queen's wish to be remembered as the Virgin Queen goes down in history. That way she's not having to say, maybe not. Right? And so that's how it stood. And then that goes down a whole other rabbit hole that you don't want to hear me start about now, as we'll be on for the next 2 hours. So you end up with H. Vere lost. But how can we be sure that that is absolutely, that's what this is, this means? Now, there's a lot of confusion over coding. Wartime coders insist, oh, no, 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 codes have got to have one answer only. They can only have one answer. It cannot be ambiguous because lives depend on it, and you can't be having to say, you know, show up at on the coast of Normandy at 6 a.m., or it could mean 9 p.m. We don't, you know, I mean, it can't be ambiguous, and that's granted. Wartime code cryptography is a serious business. But when have you ever heard of Shakespeare saying anything that means one thing? We love his writings because of the ambiguity, because, oh, God, it means that. Oh, no, it means that. Oh, it means that. And it usually means all three or four, because he's that brilliant, because he's so clever in the manipulation of the subtleties of the language that you can see, yeah, it means that. So it does not surprise me at all that he's having a blast sitting there in his tights, yes, by candlelight, with a quill, no computer, writing away and just knocking himself out, going, ah, God, that's great, they'll never get this. Because he can. There's no doubt about that. But I think I'm going to prove it to you. You could say that H. Vere lost is a very, very satisfying, deep thing. If this whole subterfuge is about who is the true king and who is the true fair youth of the sonnets, and why is there this cover-up, and why has it had to be hidden, and it's a royal scandal and it can't be known, and she's the Virgin Queen but she's not, and she's all of that, and who's Shakespeare and who's not, and that's another side of the story. But if central to it is this idea of the mistaken and hidden identity of a child, which is hinted at in Midsummer Night's Dream, all over the place, and in all kinds of other codes that we will get into, then that's the central thing, isn't it? And so he would choose to put the very, very last thing he says would be, in the end, print conceals, I am Edward de Vere. Yep, there's my signature, four O's and an O, a child. And at the top, I changed it to the lovers because I wanted to tell you, Henry Vere, lost. Lost to history, lost to the monarchy, we lost our claim to the throne. But you know, he had another son. He had, if Henry Rosalie was his son, that was a son he could not acknowledge, ever, because it's the son of the Queen, and the Queen must be available, right, to those in Europe who want to form alliances. And she was a politically savvy, strong, brilliant woman who ruled probably better than any monarch ever. But he did have, finally, a son that he could acknowledge, and that was in 1593, known as Henry de Vere, the 18th Earl of Oxford. And this goes like this, because if you go back to the lovers, you end up with, and again, you'd have to take my word for this, but you will see if you stay tuned to Bardcast for the next 17 years, you will find that there are codes galore the show. I don't know, I'm going to have to start doing them every morning and evening to get this all in before I finally shuffle off this mortal coil. And I'd like to get it all done before I go have a rest, okay? So seriously, we may have to step up the rate of these a bit. But I can tell you that one of his favorite things to do is to use Roman numerals. Roman numerals in the code. Now, what are the only Roman numerals here? I think you know that L and V are Roman numerals. Okay. Now, you can't say VL. You can't say 550. So it's LV. It's 55. That's the only way you can read it. And the rest then becomes so simple.
because this is all about Rosicrucians, the rose, the Tudor rose, right? Right at the very, very beginning, the first sonnet with no number on it says, from fairest creatures we desire increase, that thereby beauty's rose might never die. The Tudor rose might never die, but it could be a double meaning again, the Rosicrucians, the symbolism of the Rosicrucians, the secret fraternity who are bringing this ancient knowledge to us. Anyway, every single time he uses the word rose in the sonnets, it's always capitalized. And this first time, it's the 10th word, which is the divine number, divine, right? 10, the tetractys, the number 10. But beauty's rose, it's also italicized and capitalized. He's making you see, this is important. It's symbolism of the Rosicrucians, but it also could be read as meaning that the house of the Tudors, it would never die. Get an increase, get a kid. If you're the king, if he's saying this to Henry Rosely, get a child, then your lineage will carry on when you are king and the Tudor dynasty will never die. The rose, the Tudor rose and the Rosicrucians. And herein, again, there's your dedication. So Rose, Rosely, Henry Rosely, it's referring to him, but it can also be referring to what is 55? Why would he put 55 in there? The 55th day of the year. Remember, sonnets are all about a calendar. They're all about dating. Sonnets are days of the year. They refer you to certain incidents. The 55th day of the year is February the 24th. February 24th is the birthday of his own next son, Henry Vere, the one he could truly call Henry Vere, the 18th Earl of Oxford. He's the so he names him the Rose, my Rose, 55. He puts his date of his birth so that you can identify him. And so you now have the ultimate secret. You've got there really are two Henry Veres. There's Henry Rosely, who could not be named Henry Vere, who had to be named Rosely because he was hidden away in the family of the Rosleys, the Earls of Southampton, because he couldn't be acknowledged as a child of the Queen, and he couldn't be acknowledged as the next monarch. And then finally he has a boy that he can call his own, Henry de Vere. They're both H. Vere, and they're both lost to history, lost to the monarchy. Now, the only way that Henry Vere, the 18th Earl of Oxford, can be lost to the monarchy is if Edward Vere himself is royal. And that's another rabbit hole that we will have to wait on. But it's a cliffhanger, isn't it? Meanwhile, you can catch up on it in the Fisher King series. There's a lot on there. It's taken me, it doesn't matter how long it's taken me. The point is I started it as part one, part two, part three, four, five, six, seven, eight. I got about as far as part seven and then I realized this needs to be put into act. So now if the easier version to digest is act one, act two, and act three is coming, and act three will blow your socks off, because that then tells you, it ties all of this together in a way that is so beautiful, it's utterly heartbreaking. So, I think we're done for the day, except I want to read you, oh no, I want to tell you the the winner. Alejandro, who won? Michael Delahoy. Now, I'd never heard that name. Wait a minute, it's ringing a bell. It is definitely ringing a bell. Yay! All right. I don't know this person. This is not rigged. It's not rigged. He's just the most knowledgeable person on the planet about Shakespeare. And he got it. Well done, Michael. So, send us your requirements as far as which shirt you want, size, etc. And a pigeon will be delivering it to your domicile as fast as it can fly. Love you, man. Well done. Yay! So,
Oh. So the rest of you, you needn't feel bad. You have been beaten by the Well, if any of you saw Bardcast 1, the premiere, Michael Delahoyt was on with my other good friend, Michael Dunn, and we had a blast on that day. It was a memorable, memorable moment, and Michael is really one of the most superb gentlemen in this whole story, and you want to check out his work, we'll give him a plug next time. So listen, I'm now going to read you this testimonial, because someone sent this testimonial in. That, as I said, they wanted to be anonymous, but if you remember, on the last podcast, number 4, I was giving a presentation after Adam Apollo had given us his very moving description of an experience he had in what can only be described as some kind of, I won't say cosmic consciousness, because that's reserved for utter oneness with God, you know, but very, very high state of consciousness in which he felt his connectedness and his universality, his oneness with the all. And then I gave a presentation on my own experience of that 42 years ago. And the reason for doing that was to say I wanted to encourage people to realize, you know, this is not the predominant and only domain of saints. And you don't have to be, God, thank God, you don't have to be perfect in your sadhana or your meditation or your yoga practice or your devotion to Krishna or Christ or Muhammad or Buddha or whoever you choose as your vehicle for getting back home. It's all the same, it's all one. And you don't have to be utterly perfect at it. None of us is. And so I was saying to everyone, please give us your experiences. And I called my presentation The Missing Eye, right? Because again, Shakespeare does that. The missing eye. The missing eye, the missing eye. And the missing eye, that means one. Sonnet 1 has no one at it. It's the only one that doesn't have a number. The missing eye. And so I described that experience. So this person wrote in. And I'm going to read this verbatim. I think it's extremely inspiring. As I say, the person wants to remain anonymous. They say this. There is only one lesson ever being taught. Only one truth ever being revealed. There is only ever one I. Everything is connected. As a child, I was overweight, overly emotional, and artistic. Growing up in the South, this means I was bullied and picked on mercilessly. I withdrew into any fantasy I could find and found better teachers, truer friends. And I learned that magic is real. So I resolved to become what I wanted to be and not what anyone else said I was or should be. As a man, I was gifted with strength and courage, so I became the closest thing to a knight that I could find. I became a firefighter and an EMT. I fought dragons and rescued those in need. I have stood in the fiery furnace and marveled at the deadly beauty. I have led men into twisted, burning wreckage and brought order to chaos. And along the way, I developed a massive ego. I thought I could handle anything. My pride and foolishness blinded me to the danger I was in. PTSD is very real and no joke. I began to come undone, piece by piece. Suicide seemed like the only way to stop the pain. Hamlet knew my misery to be or not to be. That is the only question. One night I got a call to a familiar location to tend to one of our frequent flyers, a man I had known for years. He was usually drunk or high, always belligerent or weepy, sometimes both. He had only one eye and never would tell me how he lost it. It was getting cold and dark, and I knew he just wanted a trip to the ER for a meal and a warm bed. Just like the countless times before. But this call came on a day when I was pretty low. I had finally come up with a plan to kill myself and make it look like an accident so my family would still get the insurance money and I wouldn't look like a coward to my co-workers. This time he was dying for real, and there wasn't a goddamn thing I could do to stop it. I'm not sure why, but I got mad at him. Really mad. I used all my tools and all my drugs, and I went way beyond the norm to try to save this man. And I said to him as I was coding him, "Go before me and prepare the way, for surely I will follow." We take him to the ER, and they immediately call it DOA, dead on arrival. I do my paperwork, my shift is over, I clock out with finality, intent on never returning. I'm lying in bed, beyond exhausted, beyond stressed. I feel completely broken, like shattered glass. And I picture him, I see him as he leaves his body behind. I see myself in the ambulance, frantically working on him. I must be dreaming now, half asleep, half dead already. So I follow him. I guess he sensed me, because before he went into the light, he turned to face me. He pointed to another light and said, "You will go through this door again and again until you lose your eye." It shook me. I felt a physical jolt, like I had been pushed. And I realized, with real eyes, that the eye that must be lost is the illusion of separation. My eye is single, and I am filled with light. All of my childhood heroes and teachers come back to me. With the one lesson, I see now that it is all connected. Every hero and space wizard, every enlightened being and grandmaster of the mysteries speak to me from the pages of every comic book, every movie, every story of past, present, and future, from every direction and vector. All is one. Everything is. I am. That is exactly what I was hoping to elicit from anyone, someone, and all of us, really. Because I think we all have, in some way, doesn't have to be dramatic like Adam or life-changing. But we all feel that connection sometime. Might not stay. We might not have faith in it. We might not be able to stay with it. But I think we've all felt it at some time. And I just want to encourage you all to either send your testimonials in, but testimonials about that. If it wants to be that long, it can be so. And you can write an essay. I just want to encourage us all to think about that, because the more we do, the more we tap into the truth, and the more we can acknowledge the truth, the more we don't have to hide it anymore. And the more people that do that, the more we feel everyone else is, oh, they're the same as me. They're all on my side, and I'm part of a whole, and we are not all disconnected. We're all one. as Shakespeare said, it's all one. And so until our next podcast, which will be 2 weeks from today, probably will be my guest, Robert Edward Grant. I will be announcing it in a couple of days. The only reason we're not sure entirely is we want to get our technical glitches all sorted out so that he can present his work to you in the most perfect, beautiful form. I can present my own things. We're going to be using a green screen. We're going to have Steven Spielberg here and a lot of other people who have all... There you go. You see, see what I did? See what I did? I went too far again. Stephen, if you're out there, you're invited. Sure, you can come over. Come on. Maybe you can help us with one or two of the camera angles, because we're still working that out. Love you all. It's all one. See you next time.